music has been very good to Dominic Troiano. He has been present at many of the pivotal moments in Canadian music history from the 1960s to the present. Over the course of his career, he has played with some of the biggest names in popular music, including a stint with the Guess Who and Ronnie Hawkins. This is Dominic Troiano.
My parents moved here when I was 3 1/2, and for me it was very easy, because again I said I was 3 1/2, and so I didn't really, but for my mom and dad, you know, like you leave what you know, you leave the country you know that you're brought up in, the language that you speak, the food you eat, the coffee you drink, everything. I mean, being Italian in Toronto now is like being in Italy, I mean, in a lot of ways. Everything's here that you'd want. But when my parents came, there was nothing here. I mean, the provolone like didn't exist, and you couldn't get espresso, and there was no Italian, you know, so it was, again, I didn't go through that, but I realized as I got older, everything that they'd gone through to make a better life, and the whole reason to have a better life is your kid. My dad, actually, very interesting, had done a lot of things. My dad had been a policeman, he'd been in the army, he was a mechanic, he was a whole bunch of different things. He played guitar when he was younger, played in a band in Italy, in Modugno, our hometown. And when he came here, I think the first, he came here, I think 8 or 9 months before my mother and I came. And he had a variety of odd jobs. It was hard like finding a job. And then through some luck, somebody met, he got a job at the TTC, where he was a mechanic, which is what he had done. Now, he wasn't licensed here, so it was different, but he still was basically doing the same thing. And the TTC is where he ended up working for the rest, you know, the rest of his working life. My dad had always told me, you know, one of the first things I remember him saying to me, you know, you should be proud of your heritage. Italy's a wonderful place, and we're Italian, but we came to Canada to be Canadians. I mean, my dad always said that. You know, you're here, we came here to fit in here. But, you know, you are, you know, your heritage is Italian. And for the longest time, you know, that always stuck with me, but I was here, you know, I was watching Donald Duck and playing hockey, and, you know, I didn't understand the other part of it. And growing up for me, being a kid, you know, like pre-teens, it was just, you know, go to school, come home from school, go out and play ball hockey. I lived in a street, we lived on Salmon Avenue. A lot of little cross streets, a street called like, was Leroy Avenue that had about 20 friends in that street. I could almost still to this day, like every house, tell you who lived there. And so it was always something going on, and just, I just had a lot of fun. My parents, I like to start off saying, like my mom and dad were both great. And just kind of, when I look back at it, you know, you couldn't make a living as a musician. And musicians were generally, you know, the bottom of the barrel and no money and broke. And so he visualized that with being a musician. And so he didn't want me to do it, like doing that. It was fine as long as it was fun, and he knew I liked doing it. And by the time I, you know, in high school, I was basically by grade 11, I was almost playing every weekend in bands and stuff. And my homework just kind of started going south. And luckily, I kept kind of getting through it, and my marks were pretty good. Until grade 13, it kind of all caught up with me, all the years of cramming. I was so far behind, there was no catching up anymore. So when grade 13, kind of that's when it, like reality like set in. Up to then, I was getting through it. But in grade 13, I was remember the first time I failed a bunch of things, and my dad was very, very upset. But at the end of the year, I just said, you know, I don't want to go to school anymore. And he was really pretty cool about it. I thought he was going to kill me or kick me out of the house or something, but he wasn't pleased. It was a little chilly for a while, but my parents, again, like I said earlier, always kind of not let me do what I wanted to do in terms of I was doing like something bad, but in terms of they trusted me, I think. That's really the best way of putting it. And, you know, I think they would have liked it if I would have gone to school, like the immigrant dream, I guess. You know, you go, you become an engineer, you become a doctor, and, you know, get that plaque on the wall. And but I think the more they saw that I was really serious about it, and they just kind of let me do what I wanted to do. And I was fortunate too. Again, when anybody says they're self-taught, I mean, you meet a zillion people like who help you, you know, and you go see bands, you watch a guy play, you learn something, and records are the greatest teaching tools. I mean, it's like going to the library. You hear a guy's record, and everything he knows is there for you. It's the matter of you listening to it and absorbing it. So you listen enough, it's like reading a book, you know, you'll learn. And obviously, like reading a book, you have to have the fun, you know, you got to learn to read first. But you can teach yourself a lot of things outside of the system just by reading. And music is the same way, like listening to music. You learn, you absorb. I really absorb like myself in music. Everything I did was about music. And you know, if I would talk to a guy on the phone and he would say, oh, you play guitar? Yeah, I play guitar too. And you know, well, what do you know? I know five chords. Well, I know four chords. I mean, I'd be over to his house in 5 minutes. Like, what's the fifth chord? Well, like, what's the one I don't know? And all through high school, I was playing in bands. And by grade 12 and 13, I was in a band called Robbie Lane and the Disciples. And they were quite a popular band around town. And we used to play all the... Back then, there were a lot of school dances. Every week, there was a school dance. And there were a lot of ongoing dances, like clubs in town. But not drinking clubs. Clubs that kids could go to. So we got like really popular around town. We used to play everywhere. And one of the guys that we idolized was Ronnie Hawkins. It was Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks. Who the Hawks were the original band, like Robbie Robertson and Lee Vaughn and all those guys. So we used to watch them and go watch them play. And at one point, they left Ronnie. And Ronnie asked us like to be his band. And we were like, wow, this is it. I mean, how could it get any bigger than this, like Ronnie Hawkins? Before I started playing guitar, I used to see like Ronnie Hawkins on Dick Clark. And I mean, to me, he was like larger than life. And here's like 3 years later, I'm in his band. So I was still in school. I was one of the, I think I was the only guy still in school when we started with Ronnie. I was in grade 13. That's another reason I didn't do good in grade 13. So for the first 3 or 4 months, we're just playing weekends at La Cocteau, which is a club like downtown. And then that summer, started playing full time. I started going to this club called the Blue Note, which was just up the street from Cocteau. It was at Girard, just south of Girard on Yonge. And I loved it in there. They did all the R&B stuff, and it was really a cool place. It was like an after-hours club. And I really was fascinated by that kind of music, and I gravitated towards it. And as the summer was going along with Ronnie, I was finding out more and more that I wasn't really that happy with what we were doing musically. And I'd go to this place, and I'd be really into what they were doing. And so, you know, I kept, you know, I go like this, I'm like, what we're doing. And it finally led up to me getting fired. I got fired from Ronnie for complaining all the time, basically. And in retrospect, with good reason, because I was complaining all the time. But I went to the Blue Note, and just fortunately, the guitar player was leaving. And I joined. So I started at the Blue Note, and we were the house band, and that evolved into the Five Oaks. And we spent about a year there. It was a great year. Al Steiner, the guy who used to run the Blue Note, any acts, like a lot of the Motown acts would come to town, would play there, would, you know, do a show in town, and he would get them to come sing a couple of songs, because it was late. The floor show, he'd call it, would have 8 or 9 different singers. We'd start at like 1 in the morning. So we'd back up all these different people, and we were there. It was just the house band. And when we left, we just needed a name, and that became the Five Oaks. We'd been on the Blue Note for 5 or 6 months. We met up with a guy called Riff Markowitz, who, actually was in TV at the time, and his younger brother used to follow us around all the time. He was a big fan of the band. And he was going through a little lull, and I don't even know how it happened. Basically, he decided, well, or his, I think his brother like talked him in, it would be fun to manage a band. So he started working with us, and he had all these ideas, because again, probably from TV, lighting and strobe, and he was the guy actually who kind of helped develop our show, and we got the lighting. And back then it was pretty, like, radical around here, because no one would go around with their own lighting system and strobe lights and a PA system. And so we started gradually developing and all this stuff and started using it live. And the strobe light was quite a hit live, I remember, because people had never seen it. And I remember the first time we used it, were, you know, little, like looking at themselves and put their hand up in the air. And it was really, now it's nothing, you tell people. But then, you know, when no one had seen it, it was like, whoa, what is this? It was fun. Played quite a bit, mostly like in New York and LA, and a few of the big cities like Chicago, Cleveland. We did really well live. The record thing never worked out there, but the band live, it was a great live band, so we always made an impression on people live, I think. And I think then too, the whole music thing was really predicated on live. You had to be good live, and the record thing sort of followed.
The most exciting period was probably the 60s. When I was a teenager and seeing it all unfold, all the different groups he was in and the success they had and the popularity they had in Toronto was very exciting for myself and my friends too, who were involved or who could see what was going on, and going to concerts and seeing all these. They introduced the strobe light to concerts in the mid-60s before anybody else had done, even in the States. The Mandala was a very advanced band. in terms of a show. They had a fantastic show. Anybody you talk to who have seen the Mandela has been affected by the show, no question. They'll never forget the show.
Of all the bands I've been in, I would have to say that the Mandela probably has the most memories in that it was the first time around for a lot of things, like the first time we went to the States and cut records and played for a lot of screaming kids, and that whole, just the vibe of really being in a band that you were trying to do something with beyond playing on Young Street or something. And, you know, like when we got to go to LA and to New York and things really went well and there was a lot of reaction to the band, I think it opened up a lot of things for people here, and that, you know, they got over that hump of going across the border. There was this big thing about crossing the border was a barrier or something, and no one realized that all you had to do was hop in a car or a plane, like you'd be down.
I want you to build up a little steam inside. When I ask you to say something, I want you to let your soul out. I want you to blow the roof right off.
He went through a number of trials and tribulations over his career, a tremendous amount of highs and lows, but he didn't. He sheltered us. I believe he sheltered all of us from the troubles of his career. He bore them on his back. He's a real, you know, he didn't want us to see the ugly side of the business or the negative side of the business.
First time that Mandela played in Winnipeg, they promoted our show. They, through their the management company, promoted our show. And I had met them and knew them. I knew Randy probably the best at that time. And then when I was in Bush, they'd come to LA, and Gary and Randy had come and hung out of this house that we had with Bush and hung out a bit then. Our paths like kind of kept crossing. And after Bush, I was in the James Gang for a couple of years. So we, you know, would cross paths, like, basically. And after the James Gang, I was living in LA at that time. I was doing some studio work, doing some different things, just kind of chilling out. And they called me, said they were coming to town. They wanted, I had time to go out to dinner or whatever. We started. So, like, Randy was already gone at that point, and they had two guitarists, two other guitar players. And they told me that they wanted, would I be interested in joining the band? And then, really, my initial reaction was no, and not because of the band. I just stopped the James Gang thing. I just wanted to cool out, basically. And but we talked, and they called me again. We talked a bit more, and they were really cool guys, like nice guys. So at one point, I just decided, hey, this looks like fun. Just try it out. And from the trial thing, it just ended up being fun. And I ended up, you know, I was there till the band actually broke up, till the last version of the band stopped. That was about the middle of '75.
It was exciting to watch my brother perform on stage. It's almost like, I would get so excited and nervous and like butterflies, like I was going to perform or something, just watching him. It was really exciting. And then he also, when he was with the James Gang, saw him perform when he was with Bush and with the Guess Who, performed at the CNE. That was exciting, and we were picked up in a limousine, and it was great. It was a lot of fun.
I don't think he ever had any other dreams except, I mean, he may have had other dreams, but I'm not sure, but the main one was music, and he's been very lucky that he's still been able to be involved in it until this present time. It's been a long time, and most people either were doing something before or after or during. He has never done that. He's never compromised.
For them, that night, I think, was really, really important and really, you know, really, I think they were very touched by it. So I was very happy for that. And I was happy from my perspective, too, obviously, because it's quite an honor when you consider, at that point, there were 25 people. It's out of a country of close to 30 million people. You go, wow. It was great for me, for my mother, my father especially. Because for them, I mean, like getting back to what we were talking about earlier about going to school and getting the plaque, this is sort of the equivalent of the plaque on the wall, I guess, you know, so it was nice. And I know that they were very proud of it. And, from a personal point of view, they were very proud of it. And I think from the Italian point of view too, coming here, you know, I've been very lucky. When I look back at things, I just kind of stumbled from one thing to the next, and I'm not trying to doubt, I mean, I just kind of did. One thing always seemed to lead to something else. And like, fortunately, a lot of them seem to lead to good places. I like being around my family a lot. I have two nephews, my brother's sons, like Marcus and Julian, who I like seeing as much as I can. My mom, my sister, my brother, my immediate family. My father passed away like last year, unfortunately. But between my family and working and doing what I'm doing, the time seems to be pretty much gone, you know? So, now there's a million things I keep saying I want to do, but I never seem to get around to them, so.
Dominic Troiano's music has taken him places most people only dream about. His enthusiasm for music is undiminished as he enters the fourth decade of his career as a professional musician. He continues to write and perform to this day and remains a fixture on the Canadian music scene.
This is